Good morning. One aspect of fatherhood that I think we forget about in the modern era a lot is for how much of history being a father really meant establishing a future for a people. Think back to Abraham in particular. Abraham was not just called out of Ur to go out and follow God exclusively, but because God said he wanted to make a nation out of him. Now, Abraham had to wait until he was 100 years old for God to fulfill that promise to him, but he did it, and he did it so successfully. Prior to Abraham, though, God set up a particular kind of framing, a way of thinking about how he interacted with his people, all the way back at the beginning of the book. In Genesis, God creates Adam and Eve, Abraham's eventual ancestors, right? And he puts them inside of a garden. Now, we know from Genesis chapter 2 that there were some people who weren't in the garden. Because Cain goes off and he finds his wife from these other wild people, right? And she gets brought into the family of Adam. But God's family that he picks to have Abraham come from came from a garden. They were sort of gardened people. They were kept. They were cultivated for a particular purpose. And the people who were reading the book of Genesis, the Israelite people who that was written to, saw that. They saw God guiding their growth and bringing them to the point where they were, where Moses, their great leader, was handing them this prophecy, telling them about their history, and they were to understand that their background was brought up and cultivated by God and grown to a particular purpose. And so when the book talks about how people ought to think about themselves, it starts with this cultivation, this growth, this gardening sort of a mindset. In fact, paradise, the word we often use to refer to the Garden of Eden, and also the future heaven, has that same connotation. A paradise comes from the Persian word, which got taken into Greek, which means a walled garden. And of course, we know that the Garden of Eden is referred to as a garden. It's not the wilderness of Eden. It's not the forest of Eden. It's the garden, a tended place, something taken care of and grown with intention. If we look at all of that, then it's interesting the way that Jesus starts talking about his church. Because God cultivated a people, a family line. He led them along a particular path, and he pruned them and he grew them. But now, when Jesus starts talking to his believers about following him, he uses the same language. Now, we saw it in Malachi, and we saw it in some of the other minor prophets we looked at recently, that the people are referred to as vines, and the people are pruned by God. In that last passage we just looked at in Bible class, that God was going to burn down the unproductive vineyard to rubble, right? To stubble, rather, and leave behind not even a root. And so this vine or this cultivation language is all the way through. So now Jesus, talking about his own followers, is going to use the same language. He's diverting this terminology, which had been exclusively looked at in a family tree kind of way, right? That there was one man, Abraham, and from him all of the nation grew. And now Jesus is taking that cultivation, that growth, and that sort of central vine language and applying it to himself and his followers. This is in John chapter 15. John chapter 15, and starting with the first verse, says this. I'm the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. Now, we know that about God. The first thing he did was establish a garden and put people in it, right? He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, and while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. And neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he can bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. And if anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be given to you. This is to my Father's glory, and that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. And the Father has loved me, so as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you obey my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. And you are my friends if you do what I command. And no one can call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I have learned from my Father I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit, full fruit that will last. And then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. This is my command: love each other. How interesting that Jesus has taken this terminology, this imagery, that has been used throughout the history of these Jewish men that are listening to him now, and saying to them, you are going to be branches on my vine. Now, I said that Jewish men, they're very intentional. There's no Christians here. There's no church. He's talking to disciples in his own lifetime. He hasn't died on the cross yet, right? He's speaking during his own lifetime. And during his own lifetime, he is taking this terminology that would have been applied to Abraham in the prophets and applying it to himself. He is calling himself the true vine. He is calling himself the fulfillment of all of these prophecies that were pointing towards this moment, that this Messiah would come and he would establish himself as being the one from whom God would give his blessings to the world, from whom fruit would be born. And so for them, this language would have made sense, although Jesus sort of taking it and using it might have been somewhat radical. These were still Jewish guys. Okay, Abraham's not the vine. The root of coming from Israel, from that central one place, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, right? We could think of those three as being the progenitors of our people. Okay, we're just applying that terminology now to Jesus, and that being in the faith and following God as he has called us, that's what's going to keep us on the vine. And whoever isn't productive, whoever doesn't remain faithful to God by obeying Jesus, those people will be pruned off. That makes perfect sense. We can follow that logic. As Jewish men who have lived in this faith and heard this terminology applied to us, sure, we can accept now Jesus is the vine that we've been looking for all along, and throughout this terminology being used in the prophecies and the scripture more generally. So then we have a problem, because there are probably some of us here who can trace our lineage back to Jewish folks at some point, but for the most part, I believe we're probably Gentiles. So the early church dealt with that problem as well. And so Paul, in talking to the Roman church in chapter 11 of Romans, has to fix this so-called problem of Jesus representing this vine that had grown out of Abraham. Now, just to reiterate the point here, who Jesus' father was had his earthly father. Joseph, being his father, even though he did not contribute to his generation on this earth, was important for securing his right as the Messiah. Now, Mary is also from the line of David. We see that in her genealogy in the Gospels as well. But by the customs, traditions, and laws of the Jewish people, your claim to your tribe was passed through your father. And so Joseph's genealogy there at the beginning of, I believe his is in Matthew, let's get to where his and Mary's are mixed up, but going all the way back to Adam is important. That root all the way up to the vine of Abraham, all the way up to the branch of Jesse, and all the way out to Joseph himself establishes Jesus' sort of claim to the being, I am the productive branch. I'm the vine from which all of you smaller branches will grow. And then we get to the Gentile era. The church has been established. Paul is going out. He's doing his ministry to the Gentiles. And now the conflict has arrived in the Roman church. The church in Rome has faithful Jewish believers and Gentile believers, some of which are very prominent, some even of the household of Caesar. And they have some tension between them, because the Jewish believers say you have to become Jews and then you can be Christians. And Paul says that's not the case. Chapter 11, starting in verse 11, says this. Again I ask, did they stumble so as to fall beyond recovery, referring to the Jewish believers, or the Jewish people more generally, rather? Not at all. Rather, because of their transgression, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel envious. But if the transgression means riches for the world, and their loss means riches for the Gentiles, how much greater riches will their fullness bring? If, in other words, if the Jewish people come and accept Jesus, and they become saved just like some of these Gentiles have, they can receive the same blessings that the Gentiles have. Gentiles becoming Christians, becoming saved, does not exclude anybody else. What's good for them is not bad for you, he's trying to say. This is right in the middle of chapter 9, really, starting with talking about how Israel has rejected Jesus. And then this chapter will end with the promise that anyone who comes and is faithful to Jesus will be saved. But continuing on from where we left off, verse 13, I am talking to you, Gentiles, and as much as I am the apostle to the Gentiles, I make much of my ministry in the hope that I may somehow arouse my own people to envy and save some of them. For if their rejection is a reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? If the part of the dough offered as first fruits is holy, then the whole batch is holy. If the root is holy, so are the branches. If some of the branches have been broken off, you, although a wild olive shoot, have been grafted in among the others and now share in the nourishing sap from the olive root, do not boast over those branches. If you do, consider this. You do not support the root, but the root supports you. But you will say, branches were broken off that I could be grafted in. Granted. But they were broken off because of unbelief, and you stand by faith. Do not be arrogant, but be afraid. For if God did not spare the natural branches, he will not spare you either. Consider therefore the kindness and sternness of God. Sternness to those who fell, but kindness to you, provided that you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you will also be cut off. And if they do not persist in unbelief, they will be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again. After all, if you were cut off of an olive tree that is wild by nature, and contrary to nature were grafted into a cultivated olive tree, how much more readily will these, the natural branches, be grafted into their own olive tree? Adam and Eve sin. They're put outside of the garden. They're put outside of the cultivated place where they were put in charge of taking care of these cultivated things. They are now among wild things. They're now out having to fight against the brambles and thorns, God says. The man will have to work by the sweat of his brow. And even their own family gets a wild branch grafted in. Cain, after his sin of killing his brother, goes and gets this wild woman from somewhere else and grafts her into the family of Adam, right? She's brought in, and her children are just as much a child of Adam as Cain is, but she is from that outside influence. Now, we don't know what happens to Cain's lineage exactly. You know, you could go back to Noah's and try and figure out if he had any Cainite blood in him to see if we persist into this day, if any of us want to claim that sort of heritage or not. But the point of what that was showing in the image that was being brought in is that God didn't see Cain's wife as being evil. Cain's punishment was on Cain. And his children got that punishment because of God's curse on him, but it wasn't her being outside that made her separate from Adam and Eve. It was Cain and his transgression that separated them. Likewise, the Gentiles being brought into the church were failed like they were Cain's wife. They're being married into this special relationship that God had with his people, that they were being brought out, a wild thing, and brought into this cultivated place. And they were going to be competing against these natural branches. That's the situation that Paul had put these Gentiles in. The problem with the people in Rome is that they had a bad attitude on top of this. The Gentiles saw their special status. They recognized that they had been given a special opportunity, and they gloated about it. They sort of held it over the heads of the Jewish believers, or non-believers rather, that, oh, well, we've been saved while they're Jewish people who have been excluded from the salvation. But Paul made sure to let them know that those people could be grafted back in just as easily as the Gentiles had been brought in from outside. Those people are just as good candidates for salvation as you are. It's in that context, then, that Paul continues in verse 25 and says, I do not want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers, so that you may not be conceited. Israel has experienced a hardening in part until the full number of the Gentiles has come in, and so all Israel will be saved, as it is written. A deliverer will come from Zion. He will turn godlessness away from Jacob. And this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. As far as the gospel is concerned, they are enemies on your account. But as far as election is concerned, they are loved on account of the patriarchs. For God's gift and his call were irrevocable. And just as you were at one time disobedient to God, have now received mercy as a result of their disobedience, so too they have now become disobedient in order that they too may now receive mercy as a result of God's mercy to you. For God has bound all men over to disobedience so that he may have mercy on them all. Okay. You may have heard that some Christians believe anyone who was born from Abraham has to necessarily be saved. That anyone who's of the descent from that family tree has claim to God's grace, whether or not they accept Jesus. This passage proves that wrong. What we just read, put in context, shows that conclusion is not correct. Sometimes people read the first few words in verse 26 and take that as the fullness of the message. And so all Israel will be saved. Well, what just happened before that? All Gentiles have to be saved first. He says that you may not be conceited. Israel has been experienced hardening in part until a full number of the Gentiles has come in. Have we saved every Gentile yet? Unfortunately, no. I wish we had. And we could start saving everybody else as well. The rest has sinned, everyone needs mercy, and everyone has to come to the root. Nobody can claim the mercy of God without God. What was the message in both Jesus and Paul's words? Unproductive, unfaithful believers, or people who would have a claim to God, are cut off, and those who are productive, and those who claim God, will be grafted in. That's what was said in both places. That there is something to our relationship with God which validates that relationship. We have to produce, we have to participate in that relationship. So this isn't much of a father's day lesson. There are some fathers involved. But the real lesson here is that it doesn't matter who your daddy is, as long as you claim the father. As long as you're coming to Jesus and looking for the father that he was preaching, as he said in the passage we read, he will claim you too. And we might all have earthly fathers that we look up to if we're blessed in that way. We might have earthly fathers who were kind of mixed bag, mostly a good guy, but he had some flaws, which is probably most of us. And then some of us might not be able to really appreciate our earthly fathers because maybe we had some reasons for that in our lives. And in that way, God is more than willing to be a better father than an earthly father ever could be for us. If we claim him, he will fulfill that role more than abundantly in any way that a human could lack. In any regard, we know that it doesn't matter where we come from and what our background is, because ultimately, the only father that we need to worry about pleasing in this world is the Father in heaven. And while we appreciate our earthly fathers who are trying to recognize them on this day and appreciate all that they've done for us in our lives, we ultimately have to give all the credit to our Heavenly Father for what he did for us by sending his Son, Jesus, on the cross. If you haven't accepted Jesus' gift of salvation, we'd offer that you would come now, be grafted in, and take from the true root all the nourishment